All right, Maran writes in Siman Taf Reish Tzadi. Dinei Kriyat HaMegillah, the laws of reading the Megillah. Kore Adam at HaMegillah ben Omed ben Yoshev. A person can read the Megillah whether standing or sitting. Aval lo yikra b'tzibur yoshev lechatchila mipnei kvod ha'tzibur. But he shouldn't read sitting down for the community out of respect to the community. It's proper that a chazan should stand up when he's leading the community. In this, I see very often people make a mistake, even our own kehillah. They give you to say something, to read a... I'm not talking about when everyone is sitting down, but let's say it's a part of Vani Tefilati or something like that. Stand up, say for everybody, because that's important when you're singing for the tzibu. Haga, says Rama, note, V'asur l'chazan ikot l'mgilah shomrim l'okra. A person can't read the chazan can't read the Megillah for the community until the community says read, which is why we say Birshut Shamayim, and the community answer Birshut Moray v'Rabotai, with your permission. They say Birshut Moray with permission of Shamayim, and then we read. Chacham Odeh Yosef, if I recall, at the end of his life, would read the Megillah for the community sitting down. When they asked him, he said, because he asked them, you want me to read? I can only read sitting down. I don't have energy to stand. If you want someone else to read, then I said, no, Rabbi, we'd prefer you read and sit down. We forego our honor when it comes to reading. So that's okay. That's okay. I once happened to be such a thing. I read a Megillah and Purim was in Israel, and maybe 12 times in that day. And I asked, I said, guys, I barely have a voice. I don't have patience to start folding Megillah. I said, I need to sit. I need to read slowly. You have to sit really close. I'm not going to be broadcasting for you. And it's just come. You let me sit? Yes. Okay, wonderful. Let's go. Afilu shnaim v'afilu asara yichud mikrodah biyachad. 2 or even 10 people can read the Megillah together, out loud. V'yotzim hem v'ashomim mihem. And they can fulfill their obligation, and also everybody in the room can. So if we all had, let's say 10 of us had kosher Megillot, and everybody else didn't, and we all decided to sing the Megillah aloud together, we would fulfill the obligation for the community, even though they hear 10 voices. That's as opposed to, where else? Very good. Rosh Hashanah and the?
Shofar.
Very good. The Gemara tells us, Terei kolei lo mishtamai. 2 voices cannot be heard at the same time. And therefore, if you blow the shofar and someone else blows the shofar at the same time, you don't fulfill your mitzvah of hearing the shofar being blown. Mm-hmm. But the Chachamim tell us that because of the Megillah, and it's the miracle that happened in the story of Purim, so precious on people, people will focus. Even when 10 people are reading, they'll make an effort to focus. Because of that, you can read the Megillah with 10 people, because everybody wants to hear the Megillah. Even if it's 10 people, they won't get distracted. Mishnah Berurah suggests that if you do get distracted, then it won't work for you. But if it doesn't make you distracted, but where else do we say this halakha? By Megillah and by Halel. We say Halel even 10 people, even 20 people out loud together, because of the ness of the chavivut. People like it, so therefore they pay attention. Gimel, tzarich likrota kula. You have to read the whole Megillah. Umitoch haktav. It has to be written in the parchment. Vim kira'a al peh lo yata. And if you read the whole Megillah by heart, you don't fulfill your mitzvah. V'tzarich shetei ktuva kula lefanav lechatchila. Lechatchila, ideally, it all must be written down before you. Aval b'di'avad, but after the fact, im hishmit ha-sofer b'emtza'a tevot, if the sofer forgot a few words in the Megillah, v'afidu ad chetzia, even if half the Megillah is missing, meaning less than half, 49%. Ukra'a ha-kore al-pe, yata. And you know the Megillah by heart, and you read the half, less than half of the Megillah out loud, they fulfill their obligation.
So a damaged scroll is okay.
Still kasher.
Yeah, interesting.
Unlike a Torah scroll.
Very good. When they tell you that if you miss even one word of the Megillah, you can't, that's kind of true. Not really. It's true that if you read one word from the Chumash, it's okay. Why? Because the majority of the Megillah, you heard from a kasher klal. This is the halakha. What else here? I'm here. Oh yeah, okay, that's fine. No, if it's something we know. So, I went to the Megillah, and it says one of the things that Esther said. But instead of saying Esther said, it said the king said. Listen, no, I made a mistake. So what? I read it by heart. Nobody even knew. Keep moving.
What about the new development of people taking chapter by chapter and dividing it up? Does that count for anything?
I mean, about Korah?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't like such things.
Well, what's the answer?
If you like, they read Echa. You like when somebody runs section Echa.
Yeah. Meaning over here, everyone could do it in a group. The question is, can everybody take a chapter and read it independently?
Minastam, there's a way to do that. Why?
But how? Because then everyone would have to make separate blessings.
No, because one person makes a blessing for everybody.
And then
I'm skipping Rama. But more than half, I feel in Ktuvot, Elashen Metushtashot, Ven Roshuma Nikar Ptuna. But if it's more than half, even if they're still there, but it's faded already, and you could still read through the faded writing, it's Pasul.
Pasul?
Yeah.
I think
it was okay.
More than half.
With the 50%. Yeah. More than half. You're holding a Megillah that's not kosher. Who here is going to be using Megillah that's not kosher? Everybody who uses a Chumash. Using a Megillah, but it's not kosher. Lo yikraim shteach tzibur. Don't read along with the shteach tzibur. Ela shomea v'shotek. Be quiet and listen. Because they're reading from a kosher Megillah and you're not.
Really? Read along.
Follow along. Don't read along.
Oh, like don't read out loud.
Listen, yeah, listen.
Oh, okay.
Hey. Okay, this is already reading Megillah out of order. Vav, at the top of the next page. Anyone who reads the Megillah backwards didn't fulfill their obligation. Interesting teaching I saw here. It takes a lot of effort. It's like, say the alphabet backwards. I once saw an interesting teaching from the Baal Shem Tov, which I found to be a truthful idea, whether or not this word Chachamim meant is obviously not. He says that a person who thinks that miracles only happen backwards, only happen back in time, and is not aware that miracles happen also nowadays, didn't fulfill the obligation of Mitzvah Purim. You have to be aware that HaKadosh Baruch Hu does miracles for us also now, and that Purim is one of the miracles we celebrate, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu can do miracles each and every day. Zayin HaKorei Et HaMegillah Al Peh Lo Yetzei Yedei Chuvato. Somebody who reads the Megillah by heart did not fulfill the Mitzvah. Haloez, somebody who is a loez, what is a loez? They don't understand Hebrew. They don't understand Hebrew. Sheshamatem Megillah Ktuva b'Shon HaKodesh. They heard the Megillah being read in the Shon HaKodesh, in Hebrew, uvichidvei HaKodesh, and in a holy parchment. But Kidvei HaKodesh, that's right. I translated it also incorrectly. Kidvei HaKodesh doesn't actually mean holy parchment, but it means the ktavim that were codified and placed in the Kodesh, in the Beit HaMikdash, meaning the canonized text, like the Megillah. Even though he doesn't understand one word of what the Megillah reader is reading, he fulfills his obligation. That's the value of Hebrew. Hebrew is a language that supersedes understanding. So if you hear a Chazan read for you Megillah in Hebrew, but you don't understand Hebrew, you fulfilled your obligation. That's unlike הייתה כתובה בתרגום או בלשון אחרת מלשונות הגויים. If it was written in a translation into any other language, even תרגום, even Aramaic, לא יצא ידי חובתו בקריאתה, אלא המכיר אותו הלשון בלבד. This is going to be very hard, הלכה. If you take a Megillah and write it in English on parchment, and you're an English speaker, you fulfill your mitzvah of hearing the Megillah. But if you don't speak English, you only speak Chinese, another language that you don't understand cannot fulfill your obligation for you. I'm not going to get into all of the details. When it says writing in the class in English, does it mean in Hebrew letters but English words? Does it mean, I'm not here to stick my head. If you want to look in those halachot, research the chapter afterwards. But the Ma'ase, a person can read the Megillah in another language, as long as they understand that language. If someone knows a non-Jewish language, and they also know Assyrian, isn't Assyrian a non-Jewish language? Assyrian is what we call the Assyrian font that we write the Torah with, or the Megillah with. You know both. You can't fulfill your obligation in English. So if you know Hebrew and English, you can't fulfill your obligation in English. And some say you do fulfill your obligation. When Maran says Stam Viyesh, Maran says Halakha, and then some say, who's the Halakha like?
Stam.
The Stam, the first opinion. And if you're right, some say, and some say, Halakha is like? The second opinion. Yeah, but here he says Stam, and then some say. Some say is not his opinion of Halakha. People who are falling asleep when the Megillah is being read. Okay. Yeah. That never happens.
That one's important for me then.
Let's go to the next Halakha Ted Vav. צריך לומר עשרת בני המן ועשרת הקומת שם האחד הודיע שכולם נהרגו וניטול כאחד. It's proper that a person should read all of the names of Haman's children all in one breath. So that you could show that they were all killed in the same hanging. צריך.
They're not easy names.
צריך. I mean, בדיעבד, it's fine. That's Ramasa. דווקא לך תחילה, בדיעבד, הפסיק מנהם יצא. Tedzayin, צריך שומר ארו המן. You must say after the Megillah reading, cursed is Haman, ברוך מרדכי, blessed מרדכי, ארוה זרש, cursed is זרש, ברוכה אסתר, blessed אסתר, ארורים כל עובדי כוכבים, cursed are all the idol worshippers, but we in our נוסח say ארורים כל רשעים, all the evil people, that's what we might say today, ברוכים כל ישראל, blessed are all of the Jewish people, וצריך שומר וגם חרבונה זכולה טוב, and you must also say, and Charvona, who should be remembered for the good, that's where the Ashkenazim write the song Shoshanat Yaakov. That's an Ashkenazi song, because it includes all these words. Sfaradim just really read out the sentence at the end of the Megillah. Yud Zayin, Minhag Kol Yisrael. It's the custom of all the Jewish people. שהקורא קורא ופושט כגרד ארות הנס. That the reader rolls out the whole Megillah like a letter to show the miracle. וכשיגמור, when he finishes, חוזר וכוחה כולה ומברך. And then he rolls up the whole Megillah and then he makes a blessing. It's important that time when they're rolling, that nobody speaks or anything like that. And there are different minhagim that Rambam brings down, how all those minhagim became Sephardic minhagim, I don't know. Let's look at some of them. The Rama says, "Yesh kadvush noagim lomar dal psukim shel geulah b'kol ram." Some say you say four verses out loud. Ish Yehudi, Mordechai Yatza, LaYehudim Ha'Taora, KiMordechai Yehudi. V'chein noagim dot enu. That's the custom in our place. Meaning in Ashkenaz. V'achazan chozer b'kol otan. The Chazan goes back and rereads them. Od kadvu. They also write, "Shnaagu hatinokot latzur tzurat haman aletzim ve'avanim." That some of the kids, the young ones, they draw pictures of Haman on sticks and stones. Or lichtov shem Haman alehen, or they write the name of Haman on the sticks and stones. Ula'akotan ze al ze, and they hit them with each other, they bang them together. Kedei shimache shemo, so his name will be erased. Al derech macho, timche zech Amalek. And the way that the verse says, you should erase the memory of Amalek. Veshem reshaim yirkav, and the name of an evil person should rot. ומזה נשתרבב המנהג, and from here rolled out, evolved the minhag, שמקים המן כשקוראים המגילה בבית הכנסת. That they bang when they hear the word Haman in the בית הכנסת. ואין לבטל שום מנהג, and you should never uproot any custom, או ללעוג עליו, or to make fun of it, כי לא לחינם הוקבעו, because they never were made in vain. What do you want from me? We don't bang. We don't scream, we don't write Haman, we don't... The nighttime, what can I do? I have no choice. They pump these little kids up. And some of the little kids who are in the shapes of adults, they pump them up also. The whole year. Come, 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 you gotta bring your grogger and your noisemaker and that's the whole... You hear the Megillah only to go boo when Haman's name is said. And they come and then they say, sorry, in our community we don't boo for Haman. And then they look at you, I said, yes, right. The Grinch who stole Purim. So, I adopted. That's right. It's a dry Purim. I adopted for the first Megillah reading a Chabad custom. Very rare. You see me adopt a Chabad custom. Chabad has a custom. They only make noise for Haman when it's Haman with a description. So Haman ben Hamdata, Haman ha'agagi, Haman. So it comes after like five times the Megillah. In the daytime, I go, Haman, boo, Haman. You got it out your system? Yeah, I grew up. Now let's read the Megillah. That's what I do every year. Same thing. And when people come for the later Megillah reading, I say, don't waste my time. I'm staying here. I'll read a later time for you. Don't make noise when I read Haman.
Everybody make a noise. Purim Gadim was not happy.
Right. The Purim Gadim says that the people lose their reward by making noise in the Beda Knesset. I don't want to tell you some of the things that Chachamim wrote against the people who make noise in the Beda Knesset.
Don't.
Okay. Let's say that some of the Chachamim even curse people who do such a thing, that they shouldn't finish to live till next year. Oh. Yes, there's such a thing. What do you mean you come to Beda Knesset? Imagine someone, he invited a Catholic priest over. By the way, we have a lot of Catholic priests show up for Purim because they dress up like Catholic priests for Purim. You have all kinds of interesting costumes you want. But imagine a real Catholic priest to come. And they would see the way that Jews act in the Beda Knesset on Purim. Banging, screaming, and stomping their feet, foghorns. Imagine what it looks like. It's a very strange thing.
What about the
crossbows? Yudchet, Megillah. Okay, this is where we went last night, Minyan. Okay, let's go to the next halachot. We don't need to read about the making of Megillah. The blessings of the Megillah, let's see. Let's do a few halachot that are important that we didn't do yet. Okay, let's turn to Siman Taf Reish Tzadi Dalet. That's in Roman. That's 694. Taf Reish Tzadi Dalet, you see? Chayav kol adam liten lefachot shtei matanot lishnei aniyim. A person must give at least two gifts to two poor people. What does it mean, kol adam?
Every person.
So if you're a husband and a wife, each one of you has to give to two people. You must give matanot evyonim four times between the two of you. Some chachamim say even a poor person who's getting matanot levinim has to pass on from the matanot levinim that he got. That's how big of a mitzvah it is, matanot levinim. I never understood for the life of me why people are obsessed with mishloach manot. They waste all their money on unbelievable things for mishloach manot. But for matanot levinim, which is a real mitzvah, they don't take care about it. They do the bare minimum they could do. But matanot, no, mitzvah mishloach manot, it's one person. Yeah, get it over with. Zero. Matanot Evyonim, the more you could do, the better. Rama says, "Yesh omrim sheyesh liten kodem Purim machatzit min hamatbea kavua ba'oto makom ba'oto zman." Some say that you should give half of the coin that is in that place in that time, zecher lemachatzit ha-shekel, in commemoration of the half a shekel coin, shayu notnim be'adar, that they would give an adar. And I actually, Baruch, I brought it here on Sunday. It might be my shtender. I brought the coins that Baruch and Rachel gave us, but it's in a green Ziploc bag. I saw it on the floor, isn't it? No.
No, it's empty.
Here. You found it? Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. The half shekel coins. We have to just put up the sign that I kept up there, so people know how to do it. And by the way, you can't say this is a half shekel coin. If you say the half shekel coin, then you have to keep it till Mashiach comes and the Beit HaMikdash is rebuilt, and you have to go give it to the Beit HaMikdash. Zecher lemachatzit ha-shekel, in commemoration of the half shekel coin. ומאחר ששלוש פעמים כתוב תרומה בפרשה, יש עידן שלוש. And because the Torah says three times תרומה, the custom became to give three half coins. ויש לתנוע בליל פורים, you should give it on the eve of פורים, קודם שמפנים מנחה, before you pray מנחה. וכן נוהגים חולות אלו, that's the custom in all of these countries. ויש לתן שלושה חצאי גדולים במדינות אלו, okay, now he's going to the different types of coins that existed there. ואין חייב לתנוע רק מישהו מבין 20 ולמעלה. Some say you don't have to give. And they say the only people who have to give are people who are 20 years and older. Why? Because that's who they counted in the census, right? ויש אומרים שנותנים מחצית השקל לצדקה מלבד שלוש מחצית אלו ואין נוהגים כן. Some say you give another half a shekel coin to tzedakah aside from these three, and we don't have a custom to do that. Okay, this is Rama. You can do your own research on when Ashkenazi customs became Sephardic ones. I don't know. Bet, en meshanim ma'ot purim mitzdaka acheret. If someone donates money for purim, you can't use it for a different kind of tzedakah. V'davka gabaim, says the Ramah, that's meaning if they donate to the community for matanot avionim, you can't say, okay, well, it's going to the security fund. You can't do that. It was given for one purpose. Aval hani, the poor person, hani yachol la'asot bo ma shirtzeh. The poor person can do whatever he wants with it. He wants to donate it to the building fund, he can donate to the building fund. The poor person has, I mean, he doesn't have to use it for what you gave it to him for. But you have to use it for what it was given for. Gimel, en medagdekim bim'ot purim. This is halakha in Maran. We are not particular about money on Purim. Ela kol mi sheposhet yado litol notnim lo. Anybody who puts out his hand, you give him money. Uvmakom shnagu liten af legoim notnim. In a place where the custom is to give matanot levyonim, also to goim, you give to goim as well. Mishnah Berurah writes, we pray the Chai Shalom. You give tzedakah to the non-Jews, so they shouldn't say about us that we only care about our own people. To make peace, to foster peace between people. Rabbi Chaim David Halevi writes that hopefully the world should reach a place where Jews give tzedakah to goyim, not just to keep the peace. Because on a humanity level, we recognize that goyim also deserve our care and our support. But I'm not under the illusion that there are enough Jews who believe like that. Dalit, b'makom she'en aniyim, in a place where there are no poor people, יכול לעכב מאות פורים שלו לעצמו ונותנם במקום שירצה. A place where there are no poor people. I don't know where you have such a place.
That you know of. I mean,
you can then just add it to your regular tzedakah you give to poor people and give it at a later point in time to whatever fund you wanted to give it to. So really you have to give matanot avonim on the day of Purim. If you want me to give matanot avonim for you, it must be done before Purim. People always bring me checks or credit cards on the night of Purim. Nothing I could do with it. I have to go on Purim morning and give it to people in cash.
So you always end up at the bank.
I always end up at the bank running to Purim. I can't do it. So there's a form online. You can bring them before. You give to Rachel or to Baruch or to Marlene, to whoever it will take care of it, that it gets to the right people. But you can't call me on Purim afternoon. I already get. People wake up in the morning with envelopes under their doormats. We already took care of it. In order for that to happen, though, and we need to make sure that it goes to the right place. If you live in a place where, let's say you're in a, I don't know, you're in a deserted island for Purim. So the money you would have given to poor people, no point giving it to the monkeys and the palm trees. So you wait till you come to a place. I don't know where else you find a place where there are no poor people. Taf reish tzadihe. Dinei seudat Purim. The mitzvah of eating a meal on Purim. Interesting, this one of the simanim at Shulchan Aruch, it starts with the Ramah. Meaning, Maran didn't start here, but Ramah starts. Mitzvah leharbot besudat Purim. He quotes the Tur, and the Tur says it's a mitzvah to increase in the meals of Purim. Uvisudah achat yotzim, you fulfill your obligation with one meal. Meaning, you don't have to do
two or three,
just one meal on Purim. Maran writes, Sudat Purim sha'asa'a balayla, a meal of Purim that you did at night on Purim, lo yatza yidei chuvato, you did not fulfill your obligation. The mitzvah of the meal on Purim is in the daytime. Says the Ramah, mikol makom, nonetheless, gam balayla yismach, v'yarbe ktzat b'suda. Also at night, you should increase a little bit and have a little bit of a meal. Celebrate a little bit at night as well. We do that. After Megillah, we stick around, we eat a little bit, we talk a little bit. But the main Seudah is going to be the next day. What does it mean the next day?
On Purim itself.
On Purim, what, when?
After sunset, before sunset. After.
What does everyone do here in America?
They go to work. 5 o'clock.
They go to work. We're going to talk maybe about working on Purim. You know, flip with me to the next Siman for just a moment. Tafresh Tzadivav, the next Siman. Purim, mutar basiat menacha. You're allowed to do menacha in Purim. You can work, you can cook, you can clean. Shnagu shlo la'asot, b'mokom shnagu shlo la'asot, en osim. In any place where they have a minhag not to do menacha, they don't do it. Says Rama, v'aidna na'agu b'chol mokom shlo la'asot, the custom in Ashkenaz is everywhere, nobody works. V'aose eino ro'e siman bracha, me'ota menacha le'olam. And a person who works on Purim sees no blessing in that money that they made on Purim at all. Unless they're being involved in weddings or something that's important that needs to be done. Any kind of mitzvah. Let's go back. I never understood San Diego and how it works. People who work in jobs, I'm not judging anybody, so don't come, I'm not for a place of judgment, for a place of suggestion. Place of suggestion. If you work for yourself, there's nothing to talk about. If you work for yourself, just like you don't work on Shabbat, don't work on Purim. Don't go to work. Why do you have to work today? Work on Sunday. If you work for somebody else, why is Purim not included in the holidays that you take off from work? Chanukah, you have 8 days. Purim you have 1 day of. And the majority of Purim you spend at work. From the morning, people run out of here at the Megillah to run to work. And then they get out of work a few minutes before sunset. They run to Beit HaKnesset to hear the Megillah being read or whatever they do. And then they start their meal. And really, they end up eating their meal of Purim after Purim is over. Yeah, they started it before Purim, so it counts as a meal of Purim. But that's how you want to do mitzvot. You want to go down in the books of I'm a San Diego Jew. In San Diego, everybody works on Purim. So, because you know, my friend told me to jump. So you jump, you listen to everything your friend tells you. Because everybody does it, it makes it correct. It's a mistake. The schools here have school on Purim. Some say that they do school on Purim. I never asked. Because the other kids, if they're home, they'll never celebrate Purim. Fine. But my kid's Purim in my house is real Purim. So my kid, I want him with me for Purim. Why do you have to go throw water balloons at clowns, whatever they do? Somebody has to create an environment of Purim. It's a holiday. It's a Yom Tov. What kind of Yom Tov is it that you run away and you say, oh, the work that you do from 9 to 5, you can't wait a day? There's something that has to happen that day at work that if you go, what about the mitzvot ayom? What about giving mishloach manot? Reading the Megillah. Reading the Megillah for other people. Making food for the Seudah. Well, who's supposed to do all of that? It's bad enough. It's bad enough that everybody here in this world, they work Erev Shabbat up until sunset. They don't have an Erev Shabbat. Purim, 1 day out of the year. 1 day. You want to... So work half a day. Take off at lunchtime. I need my Purim. It's my Purim. It's my Jewish holiday. But because we turn Purim into a clown festival, it's a Jewish circus day, because of that, even the adults don't take Purim seriously. And they teach their families and the communities, look, Purim is like any other, it's like Martin Luther King Day, it's like President's Day. Even President's Day, there are people who don't work. Even the presidents don't know what you're celebrating on President's Day. On Purim, to work. If you can, avoid it, avoid it. I'm not telling you, I'm not judging. Person who has to, I understand there are jobs that if you don't show up, you might as well take off the whole year. You don't want to come pulling? That's great. Go find another job. I understand. So I'm not pressuring a person. I understand if the job that you do, you're saving people's lives. Okay, I'm not getting in the way of people's lives. The job that you do is something that can wait till later. So let it wait till later. We've created a whole culture of Jews that work on pulling. And everybody does a Seudah here after Purim. Everybody, except for us. We have two meals here on Purim. The real one and the fake one. But everyone thinks the real one is the fake one. Uh-huh. And the fake one is the real one. What am I referring to? Here, after Shacharit, we have a seuda. We have a meal. Every year, I look for someone to sponsor it. Nobody sponsors it. Why? Because it's the fake one, and their head is a fake one. Yeah? We have a seuda, we have bread, we have food, we have wine. Shakshuka, my wife makes every year. That's the seuda. Your mitzvah is to do a mitzvah as early in the morning as you possibly can. You have a brit milah for your child? Early in the morning. Don't do what they do. Now in Israel, they do britot. 20 seconds before sunset, they do the brit milah, and they party the whole night. People have to work. The baby is only born once. The brit milah. You don't need all your friends to come to brit milah. You just need 10 people to do a brit milah. And a seuda with some food. Doesn't have to be a... We get used to such weird things in the Jewish community. So in the morning we have a seuda. We eat bread. We drink a little bit of wine. We sing some songs. We say a dvar Torah. We do berkat hamazon. It takes us 20 minutes. 30 minutes stops. You finished your mitzvah of eating on Purim. Then we come here at 5:30. It's a few minutes before sunset. We read the Megillah. We start a meal. The meal, you wash your hands just in time for the sun to set. So you eat your kizayit of bread, and then we celebrate the whole night Purim. So people, they'll stay here till midnight. But that's the fake Purim meal. But people work. Well, the same people who can't come at 9 can't come at 3. Yeah? So when you're dealing with a big community, they've been doing this for 100 years, so you can't change them. But we're dealing with a small community, where almost every person in the community knows Torah well, cares about Torah well. So you can't change them, but change yourself.
How about half a day?
Decide for Purim. Purim for you is important. I just mentioned half a day. Half a day. Come late to work. Say, you know, I'm going to show up at 10 o'clock to work. I need my morning to do. Why wait until sunset to send around Mishloach Manot? People, what they do, because they know they don't have time in the daytime, they bring Mishloach Manot in the nighttime to give it out. But when you give out Mishloach Manot at night, the night before, it doesn't count for Mishloach Manot.
Or they just order from somewhere and put their name on it.
That's right.
Does that count?
No. So all of them, it's what they want to delegate other people. I called the Rapeiros once because it was a big fundraiser idea back in the day. Let's do one of those Mishloach Manot things where we get everybody to pay $360 and we go around. How much money we can make from that? And trust me, in this time of year, right before Pesach, the community needs a lot of money. These are the low seasons for us. And our Rapeiros said, Rabbi Yonatan, what do you want me to say? You want me to say it's a good fundraiser? It's a good fundraiser. Do you want me to say it's a good idea? It's a terrible idea. I said, but you know, it could increase harmony and friendship. So Rabbi Yonatan, I'm not a liar. You can't lie. It's a fake Mishloach Manot. If you want to do fake Mishloach Manot, call another rabbi. He'll help you out. And that's why we don't do it. The same thing he told me now. I was in Israel. I wanted to put Kehillat on my kids' talitot. 5 and 3. But it's a mitzvah to teach your child to do mitzvot. So I wanted to put Kehillat. So, you know, when the fake Kehillat in the store, it costs like $15 for fake Kehillat. And the real Kehillat in the store is almost $100 per tzitzit. So that's 100 for Elchanan, 100 for Avino. It's a little bit of a price difference. But I figured, he's 5. Till his bar mitzvah, I'll get him a real Kehillat. But I didn't feel, how can I put a fake Kehillat? Well, I called the parents. And Rapeiros was quiet. I said, Rav, what should I do? He says, you're asking me which one is cheaper? The fake Kehillat. I said, yeah, but I know that's cheaper. He says, you're asking me if you have to put Kehillat on your son's talit?
No.
He says, I'm telling you no, because he's small and it's a lot of money. He said, but you're asking me if you're going to put Kehillat, you can put fake Kehillat on your kid's talit? He said, I taught you to be a liar.
Wow, that's amazing.
And I said, for $200, it's worth not being a liar. For $200, it's worth telling my kid, you know, you may not remember your talit, but it was real. Not fake. Do real mitzvot. A real seuda. Give me 3 minutes. I want to finish this siman. Chayav inishti v'sumei puraya adelo yada ben aru Haman and Baruch Mordechai. A person must drink on Purim until he doesn't know the difference between cursed Haman and Baruch Mordechai. I mentioned so many times here, I can't even mention again. There's no mitzvah to get drunk on Purim. If you want to get drunk on Purim, go somewhere else, and then I'll sign you up for Alcoholics Anonymous the next day. Nobody in our community gets drunk, and if you are going to be drunk on Purim, do us all a favor, just don't come, because we'll throw you up. And I'm serious. Page 322. You say al anisim b'kad mazon. Look at halacha dalet. Chayav lishloach lechaveros shtei manot. You must send to your friend two gifts of food. What kind of manot? Manot basar or shel minei ma'achalim. Portions of meat or food.
Two kinds of food.
Not lollipops. Not potato chips. Food. Okay, what does food mean? How many people do you have to send mishloach manot to?
Two.
To one person.
What?
To one, two foods to one person. Huh? Go to somebody. Every year I do mishloach manot to one person. All the other mishloach manot I give are just like the machazit shekel. Zecher l'mishloach manot. It's in commemoration of the mishloach manot. I make food, fish or meat or chicken, and rice or quinoa and vegetables, and a bottle of wine, and I give it as a gift to somebody. That's mishloach manot. Something they can eat for their meal. So no canned stuff, no raw stuff, no dried stuff. Real food. Food that the other person would eat. So don't go giving a steak to your vegan friend. It's not going to help. Find something they can eat. But all the other stuff, the people always, oh my gosh, mishloach manot, they're sending us all this chametz before Pesach, the cookies and the chips and the crackers and that. I could solve their anxiety also. Just don't do it. Send people real food that's meant to be eaten at the meal of Purim. Chalot and a bottle of wine. They can eat that at the meal of Purim.
But nobody eats each other's food. That's what it's in the package.
Oh, see, even better. Nobody eats food that doesn't come with a kosher symbol on it. That's why we send you granola bars. But it's not really mishloach manot. It's fake mishloach manot. Shtei manot mishloach manot ish l'reihu. Shtei manot l'ish echad. Two manot ish l'reihu. One to his friend. And anybody who sends to his friend is praiseworthy. The more you send, the better. What if you don't have enough? Machlifim chaveron. Zeh shulach lezeh seudato. Vezeh shulach lezeh seudato. L'kedekem b'shach mordish l'reo. I don't have enough to give you. You don't have enough to give me. So what I do? I say, here. Yitzchak, I made dinner. Here's my dinner. I'm taking your dinner. And then we go. That's the way you do it. We didn't lose. We gave each other mishloach manot. Sometimes there are ways to give tzedakah like that also. You don't have. You know someone else doesn't have.
You trade your dinner.
You trade your tzedakah. What are you going to do? That's, you wanna,
that's a mitzvah. You trade your dinner.
You get mishloach manot.
It's a
and look,
give him and give
the
him
mitzvah of mishloach manot is not a separate mitzvah.
Or your own food.
The mitzvah of mishloach manot, you get their food. The mitzvah of mishloach manot is part of the mitzvah of eating a meal on Purim. You must contribute to the person's meal on Purim.
It's like a potluck dinner.
Ish l'rehu, my opinion. Don't have to agree with me. My opinion. Is that the Ramah here is correct? Let me read here. The last two lines of the Ramah. V'isha chayevet b'matanot evunim mishloach manot ki'ish. A woman is obligated mishloach manot, like a man is. Even though it says ish l'rehu, a man to his friend, it's also a woman to her friend. So a husband and wife have to send two mishloach manot, one for him, one for her. V'isha tishlach li'isha v'ish li'ish. Aval lo behefech. A man should not send mishloach manot to a woman should not send to a man. Why? The reason is very strange. Shelo yavo ish lishloach l'almana v'yavo l'dei sfek kiddushin. You shouldn't come and give food to a widow, and then maybe now you're married to her, because it's a financial transaction between the two of you. But in regards to money for the poor,
no problem.
We have no problem. Now, that has to do with little bits of halachot, sivlonot, and different things that I'm not here to talk about. I'm coming from a different angle entirely. And that's new with level. I will not appreciate if any man comes and brings food to my wife. Yeah. My wife will not appreciate if any woman comes to give food to me.
What if it's the two of you?
Why are we doing mishloach manot? Your real mishloach manot has to be one person to one person. I have to give to one person real mishloach manot. She has to give to one person real mishloach manot. All the other stuff, the baskets you want to give around, give them to whoever you want. But it should be a proper thing in your mind. You should bring things to people who are men for men, woman to woman. Save yourself all the problems.
Get, like, to the Rosenbergs or to the
right. So those right. The problem is the people who are giving them, they don't really.
Torah.
They don't really think that they think they're doing Mishloach Manot, but they may not be. The people who drop it off at your door after the sun already sets, or you don't, they give you food that you wouldn't eat.
That's a 90%.
You wouldn't eat. Or what happens? You're a very important person. They give you 10,000 Mishloach Manot. Rabbi always said, you don't fulfill your mitzvah Mishloach Manot to Rabbi Avad Yosef. You won't. Because he doesn't have time to look at your Mishloach Manot. It did nothing for him. And maybe if I mention Rabbi Yosef, I'm going to end on this note. There's some other beautiful halachot, which don't have time for them. Rabbi Yosef writes that Mishloach Manot is a mitzvah that's meant to increase friendship among people. So you give Mishloach Manot, it's meant to increase part of the spirit of Purim, everybody being happy, everybody in a good mood. You know, like when you have one of your children gets married, or you're making a party for something. It's a time where everybody is just happy with each other.
Where couples fight the most in Brooklyn because there's crazy traffic and nobody makes it.
Oh, couples.
No, it's the truth.
Okay, well, thank God we don't live in Brooklyn. For many reasons, but the Mishloach Manot is one of them. The herring with the sour cream is the other one. We should have in mind that there are people that otherwise we don't get along with. There's something this year caused us to fall out with them or to be a little separate from them or distant from them. Mishloach Manot is an opportunity to give people who you don't usually get along with them a gift. So if you get Mishloach Manot from me, you should know there's something we need to fix. But really, really, it's an opportunity. It's an opportunity. I cannot tell you in my life how many times I've made up with somebody by putting a little note, a personal letter in someone's Mishloach Manot and saying, hey, I know what it's been like. I know there have been some hard times. I'm reaching out to you. We don't have to be friends, but let's bridge a divide that's been between us. It's an opportunity. It's an opportunity, ish l'rehu, to create friendship, to foster friendships among each other. It's a special moment in time. It's also a really bad moment in time to start proselytizing. So 2 years ago, I got a Mishloach Manot in my house.
Oh no.
A triple Mishloach Manot. One was for me and my wife, and two were for my children. At the time, I only had two children. And they were filled with all kinds of messianic propaganda. And crowning, this one is the Mashiach, and that one is the Mashiach. And I knew who said it to me. So I sent her a text message. My wife is a nice lady, so she doesn't do things like this. I said, please, I am giving you until the end of Purim to come and get your Mishloach Manot. Or else all of the propaganda that you gave me, I'm going to throw in the trash along with your rabbi's picture. So please do me a favor and come back and pick it up. And I don't appreciate your anti-Semitic tactics in my home anymore.
Back.
No, it has to be a point. Don't use Mishloach Manot to make problems between people. It's not the point. You know somebody doesn't eat a certain kind of hechsher. Don't go out of your way to send them that food they can't eat. It's not the right time. You want to fight with them. Pesach is coming. You have a lot of fights. You have a lot of fights you can fight with people. And Purim, it's all about being close to each other. Do it in a way that brings friendship with each other. There's a minhag in the Ashkenazi communities to do it through a shaliach, to have a messenger give Mishloach Manot for you. Maybe it's a little more respectable. There are other ideas that are given. Whatever Mishloach Manot is meant, it's meant to bring matanot le'reish le'reo, to give gifts between one person to his friend. And we should have a lot of friends. And B'zad Hashem, I bless us all, that as the Purim comes to us, next Monday and Tuesday, we're not going to have kolam, because we're going to have night of Purim and the day of Purim. But our Thursday night class this week and next week will be happening, and I encourage all of you to come. I want you to know that I consider all the people who come and learn Torah with me here, all of us, I consider you dear friends of mine. And everyone who gets Mishloach Manot should feel like you're getting it as a friend. You're not from the other side. But really, really, you are the Ish L'Rehu. You are the reason why we're here. You're the reason why there are some who say that friends like that can even give Mishloach Manot with words of Torah. Now, we don't rule that way. But maybe we can give each other words of Torah. I just want to thank every single person who's here for being part of that group of Ish L'Rehu, part of that friendship that makes the Bnei Yisrael, Kimu v'kiblu ha-Yehudim alehem v'azaram. We all accepted the Torah upon ourselves, and we all spend here 3 nights a week learning Torah together. It's a really big zechut. I'm very honored to be part of this. Chag Purim Sameach, b'zrat Hashem.
Thank you.